do some stuff.
Give that a go.
Hello, right. can you hear us? Hello, sorry. We're not sure if you can hear us, so we're just going to keep talking anyway.
How are you, Beth?
Yeah, you can hear us! Yeah, sorry.
Good morning.
We thought all of a sudden Emmerich's behind the camera and he was like, we can't hear you. So we were like, if we wave at you, it makes it better, obviously.
Well, do you know sign? We could like sign the whole thing.
I don't know sign. I don't know sign.
So that's out of the question.
But talking about learning languages, both me and PJ are going to Brazil.
We are.
Over Christmas? Well, I'm going out after Christmas. But
I'm going before Christmas, so.
So how is learning Portuguese going?
So it started really well. I'm using this app called Duolingo. It's free, and I was like, you know what, why not? I had like a streak of 135 days going on it. I was so motivated, and then it's all gone downhill. I haven't touched it in about 2 months. I'm gonna have to have a translator, I guess, aren't I?
Yep.
In Brazil.
Yep, me too. I'm trying to learn. It's really hard.
It's really hard. Like,
I don't think I've ever revised for anything in my life, and it's hard as I'm trying to revise for this. And it
literally.
It's like this, like, straight.
There's some words that have like five words for one word. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, each verb has like five different ways of saying
you
it. It's like.
Sure you. Yeah. Right then. So if anyone has any tips on how to learn languages, that would be greatly appreciated. Or if anyone is a Portuguese teacher and would like to teach us how to speak Portuguese, please do. That would be absolutely amazing.
On the cheap as well.
On the cheap, yeah. Amen, for free.
For free.
So what are you most looking forward to about going to Brazil?
I'm most looking forward to seeing my friend Larry. So Larissa used to be a Pays intern here. And she came over last year for Christmas. So I think it's my turn this year to go to Brazil.
That's really nice. That's exciting.
Yeah. How about you?
Well, I was going to say the food, which is really bad. But I'm also really excited about seeing Lev's and meeting his family.
Of course.
I'm really, really excited about food as well. Like,
yeah.
Apparently, Brazilian food is amazing. The barbecue, heard great things about that.
Like, because we're going, like, for us, it'll be, in England, it'll be winter. But for them, it's going to be summer.
Yeah.
So, like,
I'm so excited about the
it's going to be like. While you're all like shivering, we're gonna be at the beach just
like sunglasses.
We don't want to make you jealous, but
I'm gonna come back looking like this colour. This is gonna be me. It's like look like a lobster.
We might have to go to the doctor if that's the case.
Like. I know, yeah. It won't be good. I'll come back to London and we're gonna have these like two circles around my eyes. Like, wait, you've been wearing sunglasses. That's the best thing about summer is when you see the people, like, they've definitely been sat on the beach for more than a couple of hours.
100%.
But also, as well, it is coming up into winter, so what is your favourite thing to do in winter?
My favourite thing about winter is like the classic, like, put the fire on, get like a hot chocolate.
How old are you?
Sorry, wait.
Wait.
Put the fire on, hot chocolate, blanket, and just like binge watch like a series on Netflix or a film or something with like people. It's just cozy, isn't it? And then you see outside, you see like people walking and they're shivering. Like you're just inside,
you're
cozy.
Just sat there laughing at them, yeah, whilst you're having a nice time. Yeah, what sounds lovely, that, doesn't it, Peach?
What would you do then?
I love winter walks. I like being able to wear wellies on walks. I feel like I've achieved a lot in life. If I can go somewhere and I'm like, yes, I needed to wear wellies.
Your yellow wellies.
My yellow wellies, yeah. I mean, I bought wellies. I don't wear them that often. I mean, there's
not really need to them.
No, in summer, you never really wear them. And I just don't really go for that many walks. I think that makes it sound like I'm like a professional hiker. I think I went for maybe 3 walks last winter. But they were nice walks.
Yeah.
I needed wellies for them. But I'm excited about that. But I'm excited. I like the dark evenings when you are inside and you like the lights are all on. You know, when you're outside and you can see the lights on in your house, you go in, you're like, oh, yes.
Like, lights just remind me of a question. When is it the right time to put up a Christmas tree?
Well, I asked Mum to put it up next week.
Oh.
And she said that's too early, apparently. So.
Isn't it a 1st of December thing, right?
Well, yeah, but if it's 1st of December, it's only up for 24 days before Christmas.
No, I mean, then you put it down the 1st of January. It's
what's
a December
the point
thing?
In even having a tree if you're putting it up then? I think it has to go up the 1st of November.
No, the 1st of January.
I think the 1st of January is a bit too late at that point. Let's keep up all year. I just think, I love Christmas. I am obsessed with Christmas. And yeah. I just think, I don't know, but like it gets to the end of summer, we have bonfire night, and after that, it's a bit like, we don't really do Thanksgiving. That's more of an American thing.
Yeah.
Maybe if we did Thanksgiving more, I'd be like absolutely hyped for that. But then it means I'm like, well, the next thing is Christmas.
True.
Therefore, I have to start Christmas in November.
True, but like, for example, we don't like, straight after Christmas, we don't start Easter in January, like.
Well, yeah, but it's my birthday in February and it's your birthday as well, oh, so you've got true. That little buffer zone.
It's true.
After that, I'm looking forward to the bank holiday weekend in April or March, whenever
Easter whatever it is. Yeah, I don't know.
That's the, I love bank holidays. I'm excited as well, Christmas, the bank holidays. Yes.
Are you, like, do you get, like, all of Christmas off or?
No, I've got to work the 24th.
Oh.
But then I'm off, to be fair, because I go to Brazil. I'm not back till the 19th of January, so I've got a fair amount of time off.
You
right
have to work the 24th.
I think I'm going to forget how to do it. Yeah, I'm going to go back and be like, all these emails, I'll be like, it's too late now. I've just, mark as read.
300 emails.
That's what I do to my messages anyway, notoriously bad.
Yeah. To be fair, I haven't replied to yours. So.
Yeah, I messaged Paige. I was like, hey Paige, are you still on to do the studio today? And he didn't respond. I was like, well, I guess it's going to be me.
No, but I'm here.
You are here. I think I could happily like talk as well to you for about 10 minutes by myself. Don't think you'd enjoy that, but...
What would you talk about by yourself?
I could do a puppet show. I could do all sorts, couldn't I?
Amazing.
I could tell you about my life story. I don't know.
What, the story you said at youth?
Yeah. No, right. So the other day at youth, I did the Godstot. So we do our Friday night youth project. Yeah. We did a Godstot. And I told an embarrassing story about myself. When I get home, Mum's like, that was brave. I was like... I've made a mistake, I'm not going to tell it on live.
I wouldn't recommend it.
Yeah, live for church. Yeah. And I was like, oh no, you know, you get home, you're like, I should not have told that story. But what's done is done. It happened. It was embarrassing. I can just add that now as part of the embarrassing story.
Sorry for stitching you up for that one.
Yeah, we did do a murder mystery though, to be fair, at youth on Friday night. I had absolutely no idea what was happening.
I had some inside knowledge and I knew who the murderer was. But seeing everyone trying to figure out who it was and just being so far off, it was
just to clarify, it was a pretend murderer. We didn't have a real murderer on the loose at you. Just want you all to know that. But yeah, I didn't get it. Even once they'd explained it, I still...
It was quite tough, especially for young people. Like.
I think, I felt sorry for the youth that was paired with me because he was like writing notes down and everything and I was like, I'm really sorry. I've got no idea what's going on. I mean, everything. I had no idea.
Mm.
I think I still kept going to the wrong rooms as well. I was like, oh, it's definitely going to be in this room. Like, it's not in this room.
Yeah.
It's in the wrong one. Anyway, that sadly is time. Hopefully you've been able to hear us for most of it. If not, then you've been able to see our faces move for the last 10 minutes. but we're going to go straight on to the opening. Riverside live stream. I'm Beth.
I'm Paige.
And it's so great to have you here. It always feels like Riverside News, doesn't it? This is Riverside News. It's not, it's Riverside live stream, but it's great to have you here on this sunny Sunday.
What Sunday is it?
It is Remembrance Sunday as well. So we are. That was like very in sync.
I know. We didn't
we've not practiced this, though. That was amazing. So spontaneous. But we are going to do a minute silence. Yeah. So that's going to be in the preach as Pastor Aaron gets up to share. So we are going to do that. And also, what have we got coming up at the end of the service?
At the end of the service, we've also got communion. So grab your bread, grab your juice, I guess.
Slash
it would
wine.
Be slash wine if you want to go for it, and join us for communion at the end of the preach. Yeah,
it'd be amazing. And also, guys, if you would like to share, comment, we've got a team ready to respond to you, to say good morning to you. But also, like, it's so good when you share; it means all your friends and families can see what's going on, what we're doing in the church, and
exactly.
It's really exciting.
It is.
It is exciting. So we're going to go through to worship together now, and we'll see you in a sec.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you could take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Breaks our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Is unfailing love, that you would bear my place, that you would bear my cross, that you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for. The Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Hey, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The Lamb who was slain. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, the power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly to the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing,
oh. Amen.
Fantastic.
Amazing. Thank you. Good job, worship band.
Yeah, really good.
Great. So we have got lots of exciting things coming up. So we're going to go straight into Riverside News. So get your notepads ready.
Hello, my name is Caitlin.
And my name is Magdalena.
And this is the weekly news
of Riverside Church.
Cut.
Mark?
Cafe Heroes is back on the 18th of November, and this time, do you know what they're going to be doing? They're going to be doing calligraphy Christmas cards because it's nearly Christmas. How exciting. Let Angela know if you want to join.
Another thing, a bit later on the 25th of November, there is Riverside Academy, so feel free to join.
See you there! And now it's time for our weather report. Today it's grey, with a chance of rain. Nothing unusual here for England. And whilst I'm here, I'd love to tell you about how we are looking for volunteers for the cafe. If you feel you can dedicate some time to volunteer in the church cafe over the next 2 weeks, do speak to Leslie.
Oh, you're here, I didn't see you first. Well, whilst I'm working on the Messy Church things, I can just tell you about it too. So Messy Church will be on the 4th of December. The theme is gonna be Christmas! What a surprise. It's going to be a great time. There are some leaflets that have to be delivered, so if you have time to do so, just contact the PACE team. We would love your help.
Hi, if you have a small child, just as I have, there's a lovely Caitlin here. Feel free to come to Parents and Toddlers every Friday. It's an amazing time to connect with other parents.
Quick commercial break. Do you like drinking coffee?
Do you like reading the Bible?
Well, we have just the right thing for you.
Prayer breakfast.
It's free.
What?
It's on Zoom.
Wow.
On the 4th of December.
Amazing.
And it's a great time to pray as a community. Come along.
Sadly, this is the end of the news for Riverside Church today. As always, it was a great pleasure to have you with us, guys.
Yes, we really enjoyed it. But I actually have some sad news to finish with.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you see, I got really told off at work yesterday.
What?
They said I never stopped singing, and they said, Caitlin, can you stop singing Wonderwall by Oasis?
Huh.
I said, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I get
see
it.
See you later. Wild, wild love.
Amazing.
Never
amazing.
Ceases to make me smile that, like.
What, those jokes?
Just everything.
I think it's just a slow demise, isn't it? Sometimes the joke's like, ooh, crash. But good job, girls, it was good news. And like you can see, there are lots of very exciting things coming up. So something to highlight is Messy Church is coming up on the 4th of December.
Yeah.
I think we had a really good time last time. There were lots of people there. If you'd like to get involved, it's a really good thing to help us get involved with families in the community, with children, with parents. And so if you are passionate about that and you want to kind of like get involved in St. Thomas, you're passionate about the community as a whole, please come along. We'd love you to get involved. We'd love you to help out. We'd love you just to come along, bring your own kids, come do some craft. What do they do there?
Yeah. Also happening on the 25th of November is Riverside Academy.
Yeah.
So if you just want to just get to know Jesus more, really, and study the Bible together, this is perfect for you. And as Kayla said, it is free, so please come along. It'll be really good.
It's free, exciting, and also as well, something that we're pushing, which we did kind of jump on the bandwagon slightly late, is the Christmas shoebox appeal. And so you have got one more week to donate a shoebox. So we're collection on next Sunday, which is the...
I don't know what the date is today.
22nd? 22nd of... Yeah. November. Oh gosh, it's going to be December.
December.
Of November, and that'll be really, really good. If you are passionate about blessing children who are less fortunate than us and who aren't going to be receiving anything this Christmas, please, please sort out a shoebox. They do different age groups. It's 2 to 4, 5 to 9, and 10 to 14. And you can have either a girl or a boy, but just please make sure that you write that on the box. or alternatively you can print out a label and stick it on, but if you can make sure that you drop that off by the 20 seconds at Riverside Church, because we're going to send them off, and what that's a blessing it's going to be.
It okay? is, it's really good. Yeah. I remember doing that at school and just really...
Did you do it at school, did you?
Please? I did it,
you
I did it.
You personally wrapped the boxes and put the gifts in the box?
I remember my mum doing that for me when I was at school.
I remember helping my mum.
But my mum always went extra, so that one child who had my mum's shoebox was...
I'm on tape duty. And also as well, we want to say a massive thank you to the cast of The Hiding Place.
Yeah.
So if you weren't aware, we had a theatre production here on Friday and Saturday night in the building by, I think it's, I'm not going to guess the name because I don't know. It's production. a theatre production, but it was a story of Corrie ten Boom, and they did an absolutely exceptional job.
Amazing.
They packed down last night, so they finished at 11 o'clock, bless them, but they did a really, really long day. So we just want to say, if they are watching, a massive thank you to them for all their hard work, and also to the guys that came, who donated to them, who sponsored them. A massive thank you to you as well, because it was a really great couple of evenings, and it was incredible to hear just an amazing story of an amazing woman of God. And so also, if you'd like to find out more, please do. I think it's called the Oddmans Theatre Production Company.
I'll double check.
I'll put it in the comments. But if you'd like to find out some like upcoming shows they've got coming on, please visit the website, because they are coming back to Exeter in December for a Christmas family show.
Oh, amazing. Excited.
It is very exciting. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna go back to worship, and before we go, I'm just gonna sing this out. I'm just gonna phrase over it. It's Psalms 95:1. It says, come on everyone, let's sing for joy to the Lord, let's shout out our loudest praises to God who saved us. So let's keep that in mind as we go and worship now.
Amazing.
I think you're gonna get it. Behold, the Father's heart, the mystery he lavishes on us, as deep cries out to deep, oh, how desperately he wants us. The things of earth stand next to him like a candle to the sun. Unfailing Father, what compares to his great love? His holy Son, the Lion and the Lamb given to us. The Word became a man, that my soul should know his Savior. Forsaken for the sake of all mankind, salvation's in his blood. Jesus Messiah, the righteous died for love. It wasn't over, for he is the risen one. Then sings my soul. Behold, I have a friend spirit breathing holy fire within. My ever-present help, speaking truth when I can't find it. Light up this broken heart and light my way until my time is done.
The table is where life happens. It's where imagination runs wild. Where lessons are learned. And wonders are built. The table is where time can stop. Where wounds are comforted. And freedom begins. It's where we find peace. And we laugh till it hurts. The table is where we gather with family, new and old, to share stories. To nourish our bodies, to enrich our souls. The table is where we give thanks and where we remember what great gifts we have been given.
Taking the time just to have a minute's reflection as it is Remembrance Sunday today. We are talking about the table, and just to be really clear, I want you to say to yourself, the table is more than a metaphor this morning, if that's right. So speak to your neighbor right there and just nudge them and poke them, check they're awake, and say, the table is more than a metaphor. If you don't know what a metaphor is, it's just an image. I'm not just going to put the idea of a table that happens in some sort of imagination. I want you to imagine a physical table, and whatever I say this morning, I want you to hear. Aaron wants me to go out of this room and sit round the table and eat with people. I literally want you to do that. It's one of the best messages that we've ever got, isn't it? Put your hand up if you eat food. Fantastic, isn't it? So I'm in good company here that we are a people of eaters here. In fact, it's a gift given by God. And as Joshua was talking about in kind of week one of the series, that when we talk about the table or the family of God, the focus first and foremost is God is central. It is his table. He draws us around his table, his character, his divine purpose. Everything he wants for our life is forged around the table. There are incredible moments that happen in our life around a table. We are shaped, we are developed. There are some great moments. There are some painful moments. There are people that sat around the table of our lives that no longer sit around that table right now. If we were to imagine a table around there, you would picture right now full seats of people who are currently sat around your table and empty seats. It's at this point I want us to draw to the empty seat around the table. We're from a nation that at this time of year celebrates the victory of those great world wars. It's easy to celebrate freedom, but I also want to bring you to that table of we also grieve those who gave their lives on both sides. On Thursday, 1918, at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the armistice agreement was signed between the Allied forces and Germany to bring World War I to an end. It was a historic moment. The fighting stopped, the weapons were laid down, the peace bells rang, and soldiers finally returned home to their families. It's difficult to imagine the relief of that hour. The horrors of the war had destroyed millions of lives on both sides. Millions of homes were facing an empty seat at their table. It is estimated that 11,000 people died on that day alone. It is easy for us to be overwhelmed by those numbers. But every life that was lost, let me tell you this, was precious in the eyes of God. As are you this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand with me. And in the face of the great suffering that still exists in our world, the wars that still take place, the profound Christian truth is this, that God not only understands and sees our pain and our trauma, but in Jesus Christ, we worship a God who suffered and died with us and for us. By his scars, we are healed. What I share this morning has the ability to transform our world and bring us around the table of unity. Let's spend a moment reflecting on those who have given their lives, the families that have lost their sons and their daughters, and that where the pain and the grief and the divisions that still exist in our world, we pray for them right now. Heavenly Father, you bring us together this morning, together in all of our suffering and in our celebration, that we pray that you would be with us and our communities and our countries and our continents and our world, that your peace bell would be rung out today, because peace only comes from you. Amen. Please take your seats. And then Keith followed up with that series of Round the Table, Sons and Daughters are raised, quite literally. You know, if you want to know one of the secrets of us raising a family who follow Jesus, a lot of that work has been done by an actual table. And as Joshua quite rightly has talked, there have been great discussions around the table about politics, about all the things you shouldn't talk about. There's been arguments about the table. We are a family of willful individuals who have to have their expressions around the table. You know, that is what shapes us and grows us in life. Sons and daughters are raised in a family that comes together. This is how God has called us to be. But food is really central. God has not only created food or given us food and given us the ability to create food, our own thing of different styles, but it's become an issue in our world. Did you know that the US sent $30 billion last year on dieting? Which is far more than their world missions food budget. It's an incredible dynamic. And when we look at food, think of the memories that you have around the table. Family members. I didn't meet Rachel around the table, by the way. I actually met her in a bus station in Manchester. But I got to know her in the kitchen and in around the table in that incredibly expensive restaurant we know as McDonald's. It's there where we got to know each other. It's there where we talked. It's there where we chatted, you know, and the rest, they say, is history. The dinner table of life is a significant place for us. Significant things happen around the table. And if you notice, the table is being expanded into the coffee shop. Significant things happen over coffee. Anybody want to say amen? Significant things happen around restaurant tables. There's a good place to go. Significant things happen around the boardroom. I love the video before because it shows the whole diversity of what happens around the table. Games and crafts and accounts and studies and Bible readings and devotionals. The table is so central in our world, and I want us to focus on it and go, why is that central? Did you know that over 50% of people don't eat with the family a few times a week anymore? That number is dividing. We're seeing this 33% decrease in families eating together over the last three decades. They've seen an increase of people sitting around the TV rather than sitting around the table. And I wonder if it's pulling society apart, that Friends becomes a TV program or people who follow us on Facebook rather than people who sit around the table with us. I wonder if God wants to do something around the table of our life so that we can have great conversation in great company, you know, with great food. Who wants that in life? Put your hand up. If that's kind of, this is the way Jesus has designed it. This is not new. It's just reclaiming something that we're doing because food connects us together. Did you know that? Food connects you together. Food comforts you. Did you know food has the ability to comfort? Who's ever had a bad day and gone to the fridge and took out a chocolate bar? There was three men in a pub, and a genie walks in and said, I'm going to give you guys, one of you, a wish each. So the first one says, I want to be rich. And the genie says, done. And he became the richest man in the world. The second man said, well, I want to be successful. And he said, done. And he became this incredibly popular man of an IT company, and everybody knew him in the world. And the third one says, I want to be irresistible to women. And he said, done. And he turned him into a pot of Ben and Jerry's ice cream. You notice that food communicates. Did you know food says, I love you? It doesn't matter how fancy it is, but somebody has to go and buy the food. Somebody provides the food. Somebody prepares the food. Somebody serves the food. It is an act of love and devotion, irrespective of whether we see it. In the Bible, you see these life celebrations of food. It pops up everywhere in weddings and birthdays and burials. Anybody want to know the only birthday that's mentioned in the Bible? This is not a joke, by the way. It's a trivia thing. Yeah, and I'll throw it out there. If you know the only birthday mentioned in the Bible, come and see me afterwards and you'll get a kudos point. I'll be impressed that you know your Bible so well. But at every feast, every moon when it rises, they're feasting. Whenever God wants to remember that everything that's happened in the Jewish history, he puts a feast on. It's 7 days of eating. Now, eating is not the focus, by the way, just to let you know. Food is a vehicle that brings people together to say, this is what's happening. There are coming home parties. There's going away parties. There's wedding parties. There's victory parties. I want to give you permission right now in your life to look for celebrations in your life and go, we are going to celebrate that over a meal. Go and do that. And let me tell you, the less we eat, the less we celebrate, the more we get depressed, the more we enter a dark place of our life. This is a new version of mindfulness, and it's in the Bible. It's called eating with people. It is great, isn't it? Who likes eating with people? It's fantastic. Every note is food tastes better with people, isn't it? You know, you can have the best meal in the world, but if you're sat there on your own watching Netflix, it doesn't taste half as good. Isn't it? I'm one of these people who kind of likes to enjoy my food audibly. Which means, right, I have to be careful how I do that. It doesn't mean I slosh around a lot, you know, because that's just really irritating for everybody else, isn't it? You know, you hear that and somebody's like, whoosh, it's just like a wave machine going on in that while you're trying to eat, particularly in the morning. I'm not saying anybody in our family does that. But I just love that. You know, you've got that. You're putting like, I've just been to Italy. The Italians know how to cook. They really do. Incredible food. We love sitting around the table. You've got Mary and Martha. That whole story, you know, and we give Martha such a hard time. If Martha wasn't in the story, Jesus would be hungry. And you know, and I want to just go, there's a serving and there's a sharing. And this is a picture of the family of God. We serve and we share. Literally. This service doesn't happen without people serving. There's teams all over the church who serve one another in love. Our connect group leaders, they serve people so that we can connect together. Some of you connect group leaders cook meals and put food on an actual table. And if you want to join a connect group, let us know and I'll tell you the ones that are serving food, you know. We know people that build connect groups that serve food. They're never empty. Because there's a dynamic of something around the table that happens that God wants to do in our life. Who was brought up with table manners? You're remembering your mum or your dad right now going, elbows off the table. Have you tried to not eat food or elbows off the table? It really is difficult, isn't it? You know, you don't chew with your mouth open. Anybody ever told that? Well, it is disgusting. We get that, isn't it? You know, but we have to be told why, isn't it? We don't talk with our mouths full, isn't it, you know? How many of you had to dress up to sit around the table? Anybody to do that? There's dress codes, there's positional codes all around the table. There's so many things. You have to hold your utensils correctly. I don't know how to do that. You know, I wasn't brought up perhaps in that type of household, isn't it? How many have to wash their hands before sitting around the table? I think that's a good thing, to be honest. You know, particularly post-COVID, that's a very, very good thing, isn't it? You don't reach across the table. You ask somebody politely to pass the table. Table manners are an incredible thing because it's about honoring one another. How many of you know it is right and good and healthy and proper to honor one another in the family of God around the table? None of you realize, but communion is around the table. If anyone has a fault with the other before they come around the table, what should they do? They should go and have a conversation. Why? Because we're about to sit together in unity and something special is going to happen. I don't want you sitting at the end of the table going, muttering and murmuring. We have some table manners in Riverside Church. Let me tell you what those table manners are. And if you want to write them down, this will help you. I want to tell you what our table manners are. Everyone is welcome around the table of Riverside. It does not matter where you are from, how bad you feel you are, whether you deserve a place around the table or not, whether you feel that God loves you or not, everyone is welcome. How far you've stuffed up does not matter to me. The fact you come and sit around the table with me is what matters. I love you. And I want to know your story, wounds and scars and all. And the reason I do, because this is what Jesus was like. Another table manner, everyone is connected. I want people to connect together around the table. I want you to grow. If you sit around the table too much, spiritually, relationally, in service, in sharing, I want you to grow in God. It's our table manners. I want everybody to be safe sat around the table of God. I don't want any level of conversation that causes damage to anybody. I want us to create a culture by which everybody feels safe and welcomed and comfort around God's table. I want everybody to be honored. You are an honored guest. Jesus is really good. He says, don't rush to sit at the place of honor on the table, sit at the feet of foot of the table. Why? Because he's teaching us a culture that we should honor others more than we honor ourselves. If we all do that, we're in a great place. But God's chosen people, everyone is generous. It's not just one person footing the bill to put the food on the table. Where we all come and we all give and we all serve and we all share, that is a banquet. That's why Jesus talks about this banquet in heaven, because we're all bringing something to the party. Everyone is loved. Everyone is happy. These are our table manners. Who wants to sit around a table like that? I do. Christmas is coming, everyone. Get your tables ready. God wants to do something around the table of Christmas. There's a great book, by the way, that says Eating Your Way Through Luke's Gospel. And the reason it's great, because it basically goes through Jesus' love of sitting around the table and how many times Jesus is eating food and who he is sitting there. And if you like trivia, you can go through your mind right now. And if you're taking notes, just start to make your own list of people that Jesus sat through. You've got the wedding feast at Cana. You've got Jesus eating with tax collectors and sinners. You've got Jesus anointed by a woman in Simon the Pharisee's home. You've got Jesus on a hillside feeding the 5,000. You've got Jesus with the 2 barley loaves. You've got Jesus eating in the home of Mary and Martha. You've got Jesus sharing the parable about the large banquet in which he urges people to invite the poor to it. You have Jesus, it's implied that Jesus invited himself around Zacchaeus's house and go, we should get around the table, Zacchaeus. Did you know in Zacchaeus' life what transformed Zacchaeus was not the fact that Jesus saw him in the tree, was that he sat around the table of his life and said, and at the end of that meal, we don't know what was said because it's not recorded, but Zacchaeus said, wow, I want to be different. There was something about Jesus' table manners that changed Zacchaeus' life. It's implied. And we read the account of the Last Supper. Have you read the story of the Emmaus Road, where Jesus is walking post-resurrection with the disciples down the road, talking about the word of God and what's happened in Jerusalem? And then they're having this thing. They said, do you what? Should we just stay and have a meal together? And during the meal, they have this revelation of God. So let's summarize what is happening around the table. What Jesus is doing around the table is miracles are happening around the actual table. Lives are transformed around a table. Acts of worship are happening around a table. Provision of food is happening around a table. The revelation of God is happening around a table. Jesus knows something. If I sit with you, you get to hear what is going on. This is a new model of discipleship. It's a great model. It's one that we're all invited to. I've noticed Josh and Chloe are just looking at the prospect of buying a new house, and they're just trying to imagine where they want. They turned one house down that they looked at, and then they came back and I said, what was it like? And they said, well, it was great. We loved this and we loved that. We loved this. But what we didn't love, it didn't have a dining room. We couldn't see a place where we could put the table. And I said, why does that matter? And they said, because it matters to us, because the way we see our married life is we want to bring people around the table. Actually, physically, as that. So I want you to write this down, because this is your challenge for the week. I want you to go and arrange a dinner party with Jesus. It's a great challenge. I want you to think about putting people around your table. I want you to think about going and sitting around somebody else's table and starting to learn what God wants to do over food. It can be a coffee. It can be a restaurant, you know, it can be something that you're working together, because I want you to understand that God wants to do something more than in that. There's an incredible thing that happens when we sit. Jesus was known and criticized for sitting around the table with tax collectors and sinners. Let's not just build table for just those who are Christians. Let's start to build a table for our neighbors, our work colleagues. What if we met somebody and we had a good connection in the street and wanted to go, should we just go and have a coffee? What if we did that? Tell me about your life. I can tell you right away, if you said that and they went back, well, tell me about yours, you've got some funny stories to tell. I can tell you've got some suffering stories, and I can tell you that you've got some Jesus stories too. Because we're worried about the gospel that we have to say four straight things to bring him into the kingdom. No, you have to tell Jesus stories about your life. You have to somehow go, this is, do you know what? I was just talking yesterday to somebody, and as I started to open up, they go, well, gee, you had a challenging life, Aaron. I said, maybe. But it goes into how have you got through that. And let me tell you, the only answer to this is very simple. The only answer that we've got as far as we have is because of Jesus. Because life for us has never been perfect, nor has it been straight, nor has it been easy. But Jesus has sat us around the table and said, I am with you. Can I bring this message to a conclusion and bring us around to that last bit of having good conversation around the table? I don't know if you know biblically, but committed relationships were formed around food. So covenants in the Old Testament were forged over food. God covenants with Abraham and Moses through the sacrifice of food. Okay, you understand what animals are. You might not know this in the Bible, but in the sacrificial process, when people brought their sacrifices year in, the food, very little of that sacrifice was wasted because it went to two places. It went to the priests who weren't farmers, who were serving the people of God, and it fed them and it fed their families, and it also fed the families of those who sacrificed. They shared that food around the people, and this is the thing what's happening. There was a sharing of protein among the community, an essential food source for people's growth and regeneration and healing, that protein was shared through the sacrificial act. We just see it as a spiritual thing. There is a literal thing taking place. And when God sits people down and the sacrifices happen, he's joining a bond through food. When Joseph is sold into slavery, as the slave traders walk by, the brothers do that while they're eating a meal. So they've got a problem with their brother who they hate. They're sat around the table. The slave thing's out. They put everybody around the table. What's the solution to this? Our solution is to sell Joseph into slavery. They made that deal over food. Things happen over food. Did you know that resources are committed over food? If you're sat around the table and they're telling the story of how they are struggling, you know what you're going to do? You're going to go, how can we help? You're going to ask two questions. What can I do? How can I help? Because that's what you do around the table. You don't just sit there supping your soup and going, ah, too bad. There is something that you are connected and you are committed to do. I want to do something about this to help. I want to share. I want to help. And I want to tell you that relationships are strengthened over the food. And this is a big point that I want us to rest with. Have you noticed that gossip does not happen around the table? There's a culture that we have around our table, no whispering. And it simply means that we all hear what everybody has got to say. Number one, because it's relevant. And number two, because it's not good just to nudge somebody else and go, it's never good in church. It's never good in family when we start talking about other people, you know, and it's bad table culture. They want us to learn what our words are and the accountability that we have of eating together. Did you know around our family, not everything I've said has gone down well? Did you know that I might say some stupid things? Did you know what I've told of joke that might be inappropriate? And it's the family go, Dad, you can't say that. It's also on the inverse for everybody else. I'm not just the kind of the main culprit around our table. But accountability happens around table. And it's good. And it's safe. And it's challenging. And nobody walks away from it because you don't walk away from food. You know, but we deal with it around the table. We've had some good humdingers around the table. It is a healthy form of conflict and reconciliation. So here's the thing I want to put about our gossip, by the way, and I want to encourage you positively. I just want to use the word, the acronym THINK, and if you've never heard of this before, this really helps. Just think, is it true? before you pass anything on. And this is a really important, is it fact, opinion, or feeling? We live in a world where I just feel that you're so horrible. I feel this, isn't it? Is that fact? My opinion is that you are an idiot. That might not be true. But we understand, we know, have to need the difference. Is this a fact? Because it's facts that make the difference in the eye. Is it true? Is it helpful? TH, does this conversation help? Some of your words do not help. It's the moment around the table when your children or your wife or things like that will just go, what did you say that for? Let's challenge our own words. It doesn't always help. Is it inspiring? Aye. Does it improve the situation? Talking about others, is it helping or is it undermining? Or is it attacking? None of it is godly. None of it is good. Is it necessary? THIN. Is it necessary? Some things are best left unsaid. Have you ever think something and your brain has said, don't say it, don't say it, don't say it, and you say it? Has that ever happened to you? All right, that's the Holy Spirit. Or that's Rachel for me. You know, they're very similar voices I find in my life. She just looks. She has this way of knowing what I'm thinking. I don't know how she does that. I hate it. Is it kind? What is the motivation for the communication? Right, gossip, by the way, you'll learn it. If you look at your own motives, why am I saying this? Instantly, that'll evaporate away if you actually just put that, because you know it's not always right. Good communication, good conversation round our table. The Matthew 18:15 principle is biblical. I want to put it to you because this is what God says. If a believer sins against you, you go privately and you point out the offense. If they listen and they confess, you have won the person back. You have restored the relationship. We have a requirement before God to be our brother's keeper. They could be offending me. They could be offending somebody else. It is a requirement to do that. If you're unsuccessful, take somebody else. Do it well. Do it wisely. Reconcile well. If not, bring it to the church. And then the church leadership have a whole framework of skills to do that. Everybody normally, first and foremost, brings it to the church leadership. Do it, go yourself. Don't gossip about somebody. If you have an issue, I just want to push people back. If you come to me, go, oh, they're doing this and this, I go, have you spoken to them? No, because you need to do that. No, I need you to talk to them. Because their relationship with you is absolutely key here. Let's not go around the church talking about somebody else. Let's go direct to that. This is what Jesus says. This is our words for that. Philippians 2, let me finish with this. Is there any encouragement, verse 1, from belonging in Christ? Is there any comfort from his love? Is there any fellowship in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with one another. Unity around the table is a mandate and a call from Jesus Christ. Love one another. Work together with one mind and one purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Think of others as better than yourselves. Don't look only for your interests, but take interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. First and foremost, people, we are followers of Jesus Christ. This is not just a good idea. This is not the ideas of Aaron. This is the teaching of Jesus Christ. I follow Jesus because first and foremost, he invited me around the table and he forgave my sins. And then he said, now, Aaron, go and forgive the sins of those who have offended you. It is a very simple mechanism of transforming our world. Can I suggest that none of the wars in our world would happen if we sat around the table and forgave each other? I'm always reminded of the forgiveness of Christ. So can I help you just to bring you around the table? And just to help you with this, there is a clear layer on the top. And if it's your first time of doing this, or if you're new to it, just take the clear line. And that just kind of opens a little bit of bread. I dream of the day when we can have real bread back. Is that okay? I am looking forward to doing that because I don't like these. The Swedes love this because it's so minimalistic about the table, isn't it? It's the smallest table you can ever get. I prefer a big table full of bread and wine. But anyway, So take the bread and just put it in your hand. I just want to tell you that you were invited around God's table. There is no sin that you've committed that stops that invite. There may be your stubbornness that stops the invite. That doesn't stop the invite, but it stops you coming. But right now, as this chair's around the table, Jesus says, would you come and sit with me because I came to sit with you? I want you to understand that Jesus loves you first and foremost. And his death on the cross was his sacrifice that gave a means for your sin to clear the way between you and God. And all it takes is for you to say, I'm coming, I'm sitting. It was a literal meal. The Last Supper of Christ was a literal meal. I said, I'm not going to do this a while because I'm going to sacrifice my life. Jesus left an empty seat around the table so that we could sit on it. As an act of faith, why didn't you sit down at Jesus' table and say, I might not be worthy, but you made me worthy. And we're told by the words in the Bible that the blood of Jesus Christ, his death, forgives us of all sin. And in remembering that we sit around the table and drinking the wine, it was a cup of celebration, a cup of faith that we get up from the table and we live forgiven. And we then go and create tables around Jesus in the way that he taught us. And that gets passed on generation to generation to generation until God calls us home. So let's raise a glass in honor of our Lord Jesus Christ and testify that we live for him. To Jesus. I'm going to invite the band to come back up, if that's all right. And Rachel, unless you want to add anything. So don't forget your challenges to try and think of ways you can get people around your table. Get some good food on there. Get some good people around there and get some good conversation going. And then why don't you give the opportunity, sorry, Richard, to say, I wonder what Jesus wants to do over this meal. Have a great time and let me know because I want to know your table stories, you know. And you can always go on a diet in January.
So a fitting way to end the service is with an old tune called Abide With Me, that standard sing. Thou thy cross before my cleansing eyes shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth shall vain and fleet. In life and death, O Lord, abide with me. Sing the first verse again. Abide with me, fast falls the even side, the darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comfort flee, help of the helpless, O
amazing message. Guys, we are nearly out of time, but we thought what better way to end than to pray.
Yeah.
So let's pray together, shall we? Father God, we want to thank you for this morning. We want to thank you that we are all part of your family, whether we're watching at home, whether we're in the building. Jesus, we thank you that you've welcomed us around the table, that you have a seat for us, that you have a place in your heart for us. And so, Jesus, I pray this week, would you challenge us? Would you grow us? Would you be with us? Jesus, would we know that we are welcome? Would we know that we are loved by you? Jesus, I pray, would you help us to love those around us? Would you help us to sit around your table, to sit around our table, Jesus, and to invite you into every conversation we have? We thank you that you have great things planned for this week, and we are so excited to see what they are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, wow. We hope you've had a good morning.
That's it, yeah.
Hope you've enjoyed the host, the dream team.
It is the dream team, isn't it? And we hope you have a really, really good week.
And we'll see you next week.
See you next week.
Bye.